And we are live on Capitol Hill this morning as the House Judiciary Subcommittee on Immigration and Border Security is holding a hearing on Syrian refugees and whether admitting them to the U.S. poses a risk to national security. Republican Congressman Trey Gowdy, South Carolina, chairing the Immigration Subcommittee, and legislation regarding Syrian refugees being debated in the House today. You'll be able to watch that this morning on our companion network C-SPAN. The House gavels in at 9:30 Eastern.
Without objection, the chair is authorized to declare recesses of the committee at any time. We welcome everyone to this morning's hearing on the Syrian refugee crisis and its impact on the security of the United States Refugee Admissions Program. I would just tell everyone that proper decorum is going to be observed. The witnesses deserve to be heard. The members deserve to be heard. This will be your one and only warning in that respect. Secondarily, I would tell our witnesses we're going to do things a little bit differently this morning. I have some colleagues that will be here very shortly, so we are going to recognize our witnesses for their opening statements before we recognize the members for theirs. And because there's a lot of floor activity this morning at 10:30, we want to get as much done as we can. So while each of you has very vast and impressive resumes, I'm probably going to skip them as I introduce you and just recognize you by name for your opening. Before I do that, I would ask everyone to rise for the administration of an oath. Just the witnesses, I'm sorry. That's my fault. That was my fault. I was ambiguous. That was my fault. Do you swear the testimony you're about to give is the truth, whole truth, nothing but truth, so help you God? May the record reflect all the witnesses answered in the affirmative. I am going to introduce you en banc and then recognize you individually for your opening. We are delighted to have Ms. Ann Richard. We are delighted to have Mr. Leon Rodriguez. We are delighted to have Mr. Seth Jones. We are delighted to have Mr. Mark Krikorian, and we are delighted to have Mr. Mark Hetfield. And with that, Ms. Richard, I would recognize you for your 5-minute opening.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the subcommittee for holding this important hearing at such a key moment in the discussions about the program of the very successful program that the U.S. government has to bring refugees to the United States so that they can restart their lives after living through very, very difficult situations of war and persecution. I know the murderous attacks in Paris last Friday evening have raised many questions about the spillover of not just migrants to Europe, but also the spread of violence from war zones in the Middle East to the streets of a major European capital. Let me assure you that the entire executive branch and the State Department that I represent has the safety and security of Americans as our highest priority. As an essential fundamental part of the U.S. Refugee Admissions Program, we screen applicants rigorously and carefully in an effort to ensure that no one who poses a threat to the safety and security of Americans is able to enter our country. All refugees of all nationalities considered for admission to the United States undergo intensive security screening involving multiple federal agencies, intelligence, security, and law enforcement agencies, including the National Counterterrorism Center, the FBI's Terrorist Screening Center, and the Departments of Homeland Security, State, and Defense. Consequently, resettlement is a careful and deliberate process that can take 18 to 24 months. Applicants to the U.S. Refugee Admissions Program are currently subject to the highest level of security checks of any category of traveler to the United States. These safeguards include biometric and fingerprint and biographic checks and a lengthy in-person overseas interview by specially trained DHS officers who scrutinize the applicant's explanation of individual circumstances to ensure the applicant is a bona fide refugee and is not known to present security concerns to the United States. Now, Leon will talk more about this. It's really in his department that the responsibility lies to determine who comes and who does not come. But we work so closely with them, I want to say that they are incredibly careful And if they have any doubts, they will not allow anyone to enter the United States. No one has a right to resettlement in the United States. It is something that we offer out of our, based on our history and our humanitarian values. The vast majority of the 3 million refugees who have been admitted to the United States, including from some of the most troubled regions in the world, have proven to be hardworking and productive residents. They pay taxes, send their children to school, and after 5 years, many take the test to become citizens. Some serve in the U.S. military and undertake other forms of service for their communities and our country. And in fact, our program is so well regarded, other countries come to us to learn more about it. And I'll be taking the British Member of Parliament, Richard Harrington, who is responsible now for trying to get more refugees through a process to the UK for a visit to one of our centers tomorrow. So I'm happy to answer any questions you may have about this, about anything in my testimony. And my testimony talks about our humanitarian assistance overseas and our diplomatic efforts. But I know that right now the American public wants to hear that our first priority is the safety of the American people. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Richard. Mr. Rodriguez.
Thank you, Chairman Gowdy, and good morning, Congressman King and Smith. I think we can stipulate to two things, that the United States has a proud and long tradition of admitting refugees from some of the worst crises and most dangerous places in the world. And secondly, that the situation in and around Syria is an untenable one, with 11 million people displaced. The question is, if we are to continue that tradition of being a welcoming country, can I, as the director of the agency that vets refugees, assure the American people that we are using all the resources that we have and that those resources are meaningful resources to vet refugees? And what I'm here to tell you this morning is the process, as Assistant Secretary Richard described, is a multi-layered, robust, and intensive process through which individuals must pass before they can travel to the United States. Given the limitations of time, I will signpost three critical phases of that process. There is the United Nations High Commissioner on Refugee phase, there is the Department of State phase, there is then the phase conducted by my refugee officers, and hopefully I will have a little bit of time during questioning to dig into some of those elements further. During the UNHCR process, individuals for the first time are reviewed, are interviewed as to the substance of their claim for refugee status. Extensive biographical information is captured, as well as preliminary analysis as to whether there are potential bars or other disqualifiers that apply to those individuals. The fruits of those interviews are then passed to the State Department and ultimately to USCIS. At the State Department stage, a second layer of interview is conducted. At that point, a series of critical biographic checks are initiated. There are three critical legs to that check. The first is the Consular Lookout Advisory Support System, which queries against a number of critical law enforcement and intelligence holdings, the security advisory opinions, which are hosted by the FBI, but most importantly of all, what is called the interagency check. That is checked against a number of both law enforcement and intelligence holdings. And important for me to let you know this morning that through that suite of checks, we have in fact either denied refugee status to individuals or have at a minimum placed them on hold based on derogatory information that came up through that check. That check is populated by the extensive work that is being done by the U.S. intelligence services, which is indeed one of the most robust, well-developed intelligence services in the democratic world. At that point, they come to my refugee officers who have extensive training both generally in protection law, refugee law, and interviewing, but then also very specific and targeted training as to conditions in Syria, including the lessons learned during the refugee process. As we interview each refugee or each family of refugees, we gain more and more information and more clarity as to what's going on in Syria. That is coupled with another round of fingerprinting, a set of biometric checks, checks against Department of Defense databases, Customs and Border Patrol databases, FBI databases, which further check the status of these individuals. Also, when I talk about the interagency check, I would note the fact that that is now a recurrent process. So these individuals are checked on an ongoing basis so that if new derogatory information arises about these individuals during the process, that comes to our attention during the process. I hope I have further opportunity during the questioning to elucidate each step of this process, because I think it is critical for the American people to get the reassurance they need to continue to be the kind of welcoming country that we are. But I also ask us to consider the price of inaction. The fact that being welcoming to refugees contributes to the stability of the region. It puts us side by side with our allies in Europe, who in fact are taking on this problem to the same extent or greater than we are, and honors our traditions as an American people. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Congressman.
Thank you, Mr. Rodriguez. Mr. Jones.
Thank you, Chairman, and distinguished members of the subcommittee. This is an important subject, and the tragic attacks in Paris over the weekend and the links with Syria make this hearing particularly important. I've divided my comments into two sections. The first will provide an overview of the foreign fighter problem from Syria and the region. The second, implications for refugees in the homeland. My background and the focus of my remarks is primarily on terrorist groups and foreign fighters. That's my expertise, serving in working for U.S. Special Operations and for the FBI's 9/11 Commission last year, where we did look at some of this stuff for Director Comey. The first, let me just talk about the extremist threat from Syria, just to obviously put this into perspective. U.S.-led airstrikes and strikes recently from France and other coalition partners have probably halted the advance of Daesh or the Islamic State in Syria. And across the border in Iraq, the U.S. efforts, including special operations forces on the ground, have helped halt the advance in places like Sinjar and supported Iraqi army operations. But the group remains strong, Daesh remains strong, and is currently not on the ropes. In addition, in Syria, the al-Qaeda-affiliated Jabhat al-Nusra is probably more capable now, that is, fighters, funds, territory, than at any time since its creation in 2011. It's an affiliate, which means it's pledged allegiance to Ayman al-Zawahiri and al-Qaeda core back in Pakistan. Obviously, of concern for the U.S. is the sheer number of foreign fighters we have seen traveling to and to some degree from Syria and Iraq. The battlefield is the largest concentration of foreign extremists we have seen in any major war, certainly ones that I've participated in and looked at the numbers in Pakistan, in Afghanistan, in Somalia, in Libya. National counterterrorism numbers put this at over 20,000 foreign fighters who traveled to Syria to fight. About 17% of them have come from the West, with, depending on how you count it, somewhere in the neighborhood of 200 Americans that have traveled or attempted to travel to Syria, mostly to fight against the Assad regime. Obviously, we've seen plots tied to operationally or inspired by Daesh, the Islamic State, in Paris recently, in Garland, Texas, in Copenhagen, Denmark, in Australia, in Ottawa, Canada, in Brussels, and then in other locations. So the threat clearly emanating from this region is clear. I note the recent MI5 director's comments, the head of British Domestic Intelligence Agency, saying that they have 750 British extremists that have traveled to Syria. Many have joined Daesh, and they've been involved in at least 6 mass casualty plots in the UK, which have been foiled. So the threat is notable. Coming to our European allies and to some degree to the U.S. homeland. So that brings me back to the U.S. and the refugee issue. And let me just start by saying that refugees clearly have played an important historical role in the United States in ensuring U.S. economic prosperity and cultural diversity. The plots we looked at last year on the FBI's 9/11 Commission from Najibullah Zazi to Faisal Shassad, the Times Square bomber, to David Headley, based out of Chicago, who was involved in the Mumbai attacks and plots in Copenhagen. Almost none of these major attacks or individuals were refugees. So the threat historically has been relatively small. But I would just highlight a couple of things that make the Syria picture and Iraq also to some degree worth noting. One is, as I said earlier, we see the highest number of foreign fighters on any modern jihadist battlefield in the Syria-Iraq border, and that border is obviously very porous. And there obviously have been an exodus of fighters into the West. Second, several European intelligence agencies have expressed concern about refugees, particularly in Europe, that have been in contact with Daesh or the Islamic State, including most recently in Belgium. So there have been some concerns in some cases after they've gotten into Europe. And then third, I would say, and this is based partly on my own experience, what we had in Iraq and Afghanistan was a pretty good intelligence architecture to collect information on individuals, including those that came through prisons. We certainly don't have this in the Syrian context. I'm happy to talk in more detail about this. Let me just conclude by saying that the U.S. has a long-standing tradition of offering protection and freedom to refugees, but obviously an integral part of that needs to be ensuring that those individuals considered provide that the U.S. is able to provide security to the homeland, and the Syria battlefield is of some concern just because of the U.S. collection gap that exists compared to other battlefields we've been involved in. So, thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Jones. Mr. Kerkorian.
Thank you, Chairman. Refugee protection policy has to be based on two principles. One, whatever policies we adopt must not pose a threat to the American people. And secondly, whatever money we take from our people through taxes to devote to these purposes should be should yield the maximum humanitarian effect. And unfortunately, resettlement of refugees in the United States from Syria or from Yemen or Somalia or other failed states fails on both of those counts. Hillary Clinton said at the debate this weekend that the United States should spend, quote, whatever it takes, unquote, to properly screen Syrian refugees. I think everybody would agree with that, but it misses the point. The problem is not that we're devoting inadequate resources. It's certainly not that our people in DHS or FBI or state are not committed. Our people are doing the best job they can. The problem is that proper screening of people from Syria cannot be done. We are giving our people an assignment which they cannot accomplish successfully. We imagine in a modern developed country like ours that everybody in the world leaves behind them the kind of electronic traces that we do, birth certificates, driver's licenses, school records, all of those things that we kind of take for granted. But the fact is that those tracks, those traces are non-existent in much of the world, even in the best of circumstances. And in the kind of situation, the chaotic situation we have in Syria, or in Somalia, or Yemen, or Libya, or Afghanistan, what little information that might have existed is probably gone up in smoke, or at the very least, is inaccessible to us. DHS Secretary Jay Johnson made that very point just last month when he said, quote, we're not going to know a lot about the individual refugees who come forward, unquote. That's true. And in fact, just this week, we found more evidence of that. The French sent our intelligence agencies the fingerprints of the attackers in Paris, and there was no trace of them anywhere in our databases, the very databases that we're supposed to be using to screen the Syrian refugees. Our screening of refugees resembles, and I don't mean to be flip here, but it really does resemble the joke about the drunk who loses his keys in the park but is searching for them under the streetlight, and when asked why he's doing that, he said, well, the light's better here. The clearest statement of this came from Matthew Emmerich, nothing personal, Mr. Emmerich, who's in charge of fraud detection at USCIS. He told the Senate last month, quote, we check everything that we are aware of within U.S. government holdings, because the light's better there. The second point is efficacy. In other words, are the resources we're devoting to humanitarian protection for refugees, whether Syria or anywhere else, being used to the maximum effect. And, you know, bringing refugees to our country makes us feel better. I assume Mr. Hetfield will give us some warm stories about that, and it does make us feel better. But the point of humanitarian protection of refugees is not to make us feel better. It's to assist as many people as possible with whatever resources we've decided to devote to this purpose. And what we found, we did research on this, and we found that it costs 12 times as much to resettle a refugee from Syria, from the Middle East, in the United States, as it does to provide for them in their own region. In this case, in, say, Syrian refugees in Turkey or Jordan or Lebanon, which is where most of them are. The five-year cost, we conservatively estimated, of resettling a refugee from the Middle East is $64,000, compared to UN figures that indicated the five-year cost for caring for people in the region would be about $5,300. In other words, each refugee that we bring to the United States from the Middle East means that 11 other people are not being helped with those same resources. The image I like to think about when considering this is, imagine you have 12 drowning people. What are you going to do? Do you send them a one-man yacht that's a very nice, beautiful yacht but holds only one person, or do you throw them 12 life preservers? The moral choice is obvious there, and yet what we're doing through the best of intentions is sending the one-person yacht instead of throwing them 12 life preservers. In conclusion, Congress has a variety of measures to address the Syrian refugee issue, and I'm not qualified to say whether we should have a temporary pause or whether there should be a suspension of funding or a broad change in the rules. These are questions you're going to consider. But in considering them, I urge you to keep in mind these two points. The only way to reduce the security risk of resettling Syrian refugees, or Somali, or Yemeni, or Libyan, or Afghan, is to reduce the number that we resettle. And the government's obligation to make the most effective use of the funding that we have taken from our people to devote to refugee protection compels a shift in emphasis away from resettlement toward greater protection for people in the region. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hetfield.
Thank you, Chairman Gowdy. Thank you, Ranking Member Lofgren, for honoring HIAS by having me testify here today. HIAS is the oldest refugee agency.
Your mic isn't on.
Can you hear me now? Okay. Thank you, Chairman Gowdy, Ranking Member Lofgren, and distinguished members of the subcommittee for inviting me to speak here today on behalf of HIAS, which is the oldest refugee agency in the world. We've been resettling refugees since 1881, not just because it makes us feel better, but because it saves lives. Refugee resettlement has saved millions of lives since 1881, but not nearly enough. We're confronting the world's most horrific refugee crisis since World War II, with 60 million displaced across the globe, 20% of whom are Syrian, fleeing a conflict that has already taken over 240,000 lives. Without considerably more international assistance, countries like Lebanon, Jordan, and Turkey are beyond their saturation points, with over 4 million Syrians, causing refugees to risk their lives to flee for a second or a third time. The crisis finally attracted international attention and attention in this country when the body of three-year-old Syrian Elan Kurdi washed up on a Turkish beach on September 2nd, one of 813 men, women, and children asylum seekers to perish at sea that month, trying to make the perilous journey to Europe. This is an extraordinary crisis requiring extraordinary leadership, but so far the United States' response has been tepid at best. While this is the largest refugee crisis of my lifetime, we're resettling far fewer refugees than we did in 1980, when we resettled over 200,000 Indochinese refugees, or in 1993 and 1994, when we resettled well over 110,000 refugees each year. But my great sadness at the murderous acts of terrorism perpetrated in Beirut and Paris last week has been compounded by the reactions of some politicians in this country. They have diverted the focus away from fighting terrorism and toward keeping refugees out of our country and out of their states. They have blamed the victims. This plays on people's fears, turns prejudice into policy, and weakens our national security and our national character. I mistakenly thought that attitudes and signs like Irish need not apply, no coloreds, no Jews or dogs allowed, were ugly relics buried in the past, but apparently not. Governors are clearly saying openly, no Syrian Muslims are welcome in my state. One governor even said, from my home state of New Jersey, no Syrian orphans under 5 were welcome either, which can only recall the ugly debate that occurred in this House in 1939, which resulted in the defeat of the Wagner-Rogers bill, which would have saved 20,000 refugee children from Nazi Germany. Governors are right to be concerned about security, but so is the federal government, so are the refugee resettlement agencies, and the extensive screening process in our refugee program reflects that, as Director Rodriguez has already testified, and as is in my testimony. While the number of Syrian refugees being resettled here today is relatively anemic, the security protocols in place are stronger than anything I have ever seen in my 26 years working in this field. So strong that it has made the refugee resettlement program into more fortress than ambulance, causing massive backlogs of holds of legitimately deserving and unnecessarily suffering refugees. The fear of resettled refugees here is based on erroneous assumptions. The flow of refugees to Europe is entirely dissimilar to the refugees accepted through the U.S. Refugee Resettlement Program. The refugees who arrive in the U.S. have undergone extensive security vetting prior to setting foot on U.S. soil. Refugees to Europe are not screened until after they enter. This is the distinction. It simply does not make sense for U.S. lawmakers to react to the tragedy in Paris by proposing legislative changes to the U.S. refugee program. History has demonstrated that our democracy can not only withstand large influxes of refugees from other countries, but will prosper as a result. When we welcomed millions of refugees from communist, fascist, and Nazi regimes, our country did not become infected with any of these ideologies, nor with the terror associated with them. If anything, these refugees immunized us from the totalitarian ideologies they were fleeing. The USRAP is hardly a piece of Swiss cheese. It is not a sieve, and in essence, it is not even the wide-reaching rescue program that it was intended to be. Given the complexity, intrusiveness, and unpredictability of the program for refugees, it seems highly unlikely, if not impossible, that a terrorist would choose the refugee resettlement program as his or her pathway to the U.S. My written testimony outlines a number of suggestions to improve the program while increasing both security and efficiency, but it does not recommend a certification process. Thank you for inviting me to testify here today on Syrian refugees. This country must continue to be both welcoming and safe.
Thank you, Mr. Hetfield. I will remind the witnesses and the members to direct their responses and comments to the appropriate audiences. For members, it would be not to one another, and to witnesses, it would be not to one another. With that, I would recognize the ranking member of the full committee, the gentleman from Michigan, Mr. Conyers.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I apologize for appearing late, but this is an important hearing which focuses on the Syrian refugee crisis and its impact on the security of our nation's refugee admissions program has the potential to shed meaningful light on critical issues of interest to all Americans, to all of us. Unfortunately, the value of today's undertaking is greatly diminished by the fact that immediately following the conclusion of this hearing, we will go directly to the floor to vote on H.R. 4038, the so-called American SAFE Act, a bill that would effectively shut down refugee processing for Syrians and Iraqis. Clearly, there are no easy solutions to a humanitarian crisis of this magnitude, as well as the security threats we will hear about today. Yet, 4038 is not the right answer, in my view, and I want the witnesses to please let us know what should be our response, keeping in mind these factors. To begin with, while ensuring that the safety of all Americans should be our top priority. H.R. 4038, which would effectively debar Syrian and Iraqi refugees from the U.S. Refugee Admissions Program, it does nothing to promote security. This measure sets unreasonable clearance standards that the Department of Homeland Security cannot meet, and thereby it would halt refugee resettlement in the United States, which is perhaps what the whole point of their doing this is. So without question, the program should be held to the highest standards to ensure, to the greatest extent possible, that the security screening is thorough, effective, and timely. In fact, refugees are already subject to the highest level of vetting, more than any other traveler or immigrant to the United States. This extensive screening process performed by the Departments of Homeland Security and State in conjunction with the CIA, the FBI, and other law enforcement agencies relies on methodical and exhaustive background checks that often take up to 24 months on average to complete, and even longer in some cases. But like any system, there can be room for further improvement. So I'd appreciate your thoughts here and after this hearing on how we can accomplish that goal. We must keep in mind that our nation was founded by immigrants and has historically welcomed refugees when they're suffering around the globe, whether it's an earthquake in Haiti, a tsunami in Asia, or 4 years of civil war in Syria with no end in sight. The world looks to the United States. We provide protections for refugees and asylum seekers, especially women and children. Nevertheless, in the wake of September 11 attack on our shores and the tragic November 13 terror attacks in Paris, we must be vigilant, especially in the midst of a global refugee crisis. The measure I keep referring to, however, is an extreme overreaction to these latest security concerns. Rather than shutting our doors to the desperate men and women and children who are risking their lives to escape death and torture in their own homelands, we should work to utilize our immense resources and good intentions of our citizens to welcome them. And finally, Congress needs to do its part by properly funding refugee resettlement, as well as funding our federal agencies so that they have the necessary personnel and programs to complete security checks. Rather than slamming the doors to the world's most vulnerable, we should be considering legislation to strengthen and expand refugee programs. For example, I'm a co-sponsor of H.R. 1568, the Protecting Religious Minorities Persecuted by ISIS Act, which allows persecuted individuals in ISIS-held territories in Iraq and Syria to apply directly to the U.S. Refugee Admissions Program, rather than rushing to the floor to consider legislation that was introduced just 2 days ago and has not been subject to even a single hearing. We should devote our legislative resources to developing meaningful solutions. And I thank the chair very much for this opportunity.
I thank the gentleman from Michigan. The chair will now recognize himself for an opening statement. National security and public safety are the preeminent functions of government. National security and public safety are not simply factors to be considered in the administration of some broader policy objective. National security and public safety are the ultimate policy objectives. The safety and security of our fellow citizens should be the driving force behind all decisions that we make as representatives. And as representatives, it would be incongruent for us to undertake any act or fail to undertake an act calculated to jeopardize the safety and security of those who sent us here in the first place. People do not employ us to represent them so we can take risk with their security. They send us here to put their security at the top of our constitutional to-do list. This country has a rich and long history of welcoming those fleeing persecution. We have a long and rich history of liberating those suffering under oppression. We are the most welcoming country in the world, and we are the most generous country in the world. And we help those in need both here and abroad, and we administer that aid in greater quantities than anyone else. Our country has welcomed over 3 million refugees since 1975. We consistently provide aid to those in need. We provide protection for those who cannot protect themselves, and we provide a defense for those who are defenseless. Regrettably, the world we find ourselves in is imperfect and seemingly becoming more imperfect. It is because we are free and secure and an orderly society rooted in public safety that we have the liberty of being generous to other people. Rather than address the underlying pathology that results in displaced people, those in charge of our foreign policy seem more interested in treating the symptoms. There are refugees from the Middle East and Northern Africa because those regions are on fire and riddled with chaos, and our bright lines and policies of containment and smart power, or whatever we call it today, have failed. Terrorists took the lives of over 100 innocent people in France and injured many more for no other reason than the fact that they could. They killed 100 because they couldn't kill 1,000. And their objective is evil for the sake of evil. It is murder for the sake of murder. It is wanton and willful violence, premeditated depravity, calculated to take as many innocent lives as possible. The acts of barbarism committed against the people of France are the latest in a long line of malevolent acts committed against innocents. And that line is not likely to be over. CIA Director Brennan said what happened in France was not a one-off event. We also know ISIS terrorists are intent on finding ways to attack America and our allies, including here. Director Brennan said ISIS has an external agenda they are determined to carry out. Another administration official said, I wouldn't put it past ISIS to infiltrate operatives among refugees, so that's a huge concern of ours. Those are not the words of some GOP presidential hopeful. Those are the words of our very own intelligence officials who serve this administration. The president has said he's too busy to debate the critical issue, and unfortunately what passes for debate in this political day and age is some absurd conclusion about widows and orphans. It is precisely that kind of hyper-partisan conclusion designed to cut off debate rather than discuss foreign policy that has united this country in only this one fact. We have no idea what our foreign policy is in the Middle East. The people I represent are kind and generous, and they are asking this administration and this president one simple question. What assurance can you give us with respect to our public safety and national security? And so far, no one has been able to provide that assurance. On Monday, the president said the country would continue to accept Syrian refugees, but only after subjecting them to rigorous screening and security checks. Those are wonderful words. But at some point, you have to ask, what does that mean? And the head of our own FBI said the concern in Syria, the lack of our footprint on the ground in Syria, that the databases won't have the information we need, so it's not that we don't have a process, we don't have any information. So you're talking about a country that's a failed state, that doesn't have any infrastructure, all the data sets, the police, the intel services you normally would go to and seek that information don't exist. That is not a Republican presidential hopeful. That is the head of the FBI. He also said we can only query against that which we've collected. And so if someone has never made a ripple in a pond in Syria, or I'll add any other place, in a way that would get their identity or their interest reflected in our database, we can query our database until the cows come home. But nothing will show up because there is no record on that person. Lastly, he said, I can't sit here and offer anybody an absolute assurance that there's no risk associated with this. So the question then becomes, what amount of risk is acceptable? If our experts are telling us this is not a risk-free endeavor, and few things in life are, but someone's going to need to tell me and the people I work for, what amount of risk is acceptable when you're talking about national security and public safety? And I'll say this in conclusion. The president says we're scared of widows and orphans. With all due respect to him, what I'm really afraid of is a foreign policy that creates more widows and orphans. So where maybe he ought to start, is a foreign policy in the Middle East, including Syria, where people can go back to their homelands, which is their preference, go back to their homelands. Maybe you ought to defeat that JV team that you thought you had contained. That would be the very best thing you could do to help people who aspire to a better life. And with that, I would recognize the gentlelady from California.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. When we're elected to Congress, our first responsibility is to make sure that the security of the American people is attended to. That's number one, two, three, four. That's the first obligation. And I take it very seriously. That admonition has caused me, once again, to review the procedures and policies and laws relative to our refugee programs. Now, refugees from Syria and other places in the Middle East are arriving in waves, unscreened, at Europe's doorstep. As Mr. Hetfield has recalled, we were shocked to see the body of a three-year-old child on the beach, families trying to escape from ISIS, who is beheading people. But our process is different. We have an ocean between us and Europe and the Middle East, and that has allowed us to provide for a rather extensive process, and here's really what it is. I mean, in order to even be considered, the United Nations High Commission on Refugee refers you to our system for screening, and only a few people actually make that process to be screened. At that point, we have a resettlement support center that does an interview. We do biographic checks. Then we use the CLAS system, the Consular Lookout and Support System, which queries data. It's classified what all of it is, but it includes the DEA, the FBI, Homeland Security, Immigration, Customs, on and on, the Marshals Service. Then we have, for certain refugees, and that includes Assyrians, a security advisory opinion, which is a positive SAO clearance from a number of U.S. law enforcement and intelligence agencies. Again, the participants are classified, but it is everybody. And then we have the interagency check, which was new. Before 2008 in this administration, we didn't have that, and unfortunately, we admitted four Iraqi refugees who turned out to be terrorists under the Bush administration. We reviewed the process and changed that to avoid that a repetition of that, as well as the biometric checks and the next generation information system, along with IDENT, the automated biographic identification system, and the automated biographic identification system. That's all followed by in-person interviews and some post-interview efforts. Following that, there are additional checks for Syrians. So it's no small surprise that this process takes a couple of years for someone to pass. Now, you know, I listen to the FBI director, who we all respect, but I'm mindful the FBI essentially has a veto. I mean, if there's somebody that we don't know who they are, they can't come in. That's our process. They can't come in. That's the current law. And that's as it should be. You know, that we would think querying what Assad thinks about a refugee, I don't really care what Assad thinks about a refugee. He thinks all the Sunnis are terrorists, and they're not. So let's put this in a perspective. If I were a terrorist, would I say, well, I'm going to go to a camp, hope that the UN will refer me to the system, go through this extensive process for 2 years, and honestly, because of Paris, this has now been further extended because everyone wants to make sure that every T is crossed and I is dotted. And in 2 or 3 years, if I'm lucky, I might make it as a refugee. I don't think so. We need to take a look at all of the systems that we have. Most of the terrorists, it looks like at this point all of the terrorists in Paris were Europeans. They had European passports. They had Belgium and French passports. They could come to the United States very easily. And so I think we need to take a look at what processes we have in place to make sure that the country is safe. But it doesn't include being afraid of a five-year-old. And I think, I just want to say, Mr. Hetfield, it's important that you are here. I was listening to my colleague, Luis Gutierrez, and yesterday, a Syrian family, refugees, arrived in Chicago. And the nonprofit group that was resettling them was the Jewish Community Center. That tells ISIS and the world that we're on the right side of history and they're on the wrong side of history. How do you recruit more terrorists when the United States stands up for what it is? And that's part of this equation. We need to win this militarily, but we also need to win it in a value fight. And we're not going to win that value fight by backing off from being free and being American. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Gentlelady yields back. Chair would now recognize the gentleman from Virginia, the chairman of the full committee, Mr. Goodlatte.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. From an immigration standpoint, perhaps the most essential lesson from the 9/11 terrorist acts is that foreign nationals who want to do us harm will exploit all aspects of our generous immigration policy to do so, even if it takes months or years. Tragically, our allies in France learned that same lesson when over 120 people, including at least one American, were slaughtered by ISIS terrorists. And we know that at least one of the perpetrators registered as a refugee from Syria while in transit to Paris. Armed with that knowledge, today we examine the administration's plan to admit thousands of Syrians into the U.S. as refugees. During fiscal year 2015, the President admitted 1,682 Syrian refugees to the U.S. Then in late September, the administration announced that during this fiscal year, they plan to admit at least 10,000 more. And that number could go even higher, as Secretary of State John Kerry stated. I underscore the at least. It is not a ceiling, it is a floor. So since the overall ceiling for fiscal year 2016 refugee resettlement is 85,000, at a minimum, according to the Secretary of State, nearly 12% will be from a country with little infrastructure in complete turmoil into which thousands of radicalized foreign fighters have poured, parts of which the Islamic State controls and in which we have no law enforcement presence. I understand that the administration conducts security checks prior to admitting refugees, and according to the administration, these checks are robust, especially with regard to the Syrian population. But are they enough? Can these checks ensure that the individuals admitted as refugees are not terrorists and will not commit terrorist attacks once in the United States? DHS Secretary Jay Johnson told Congress that agencies involved in the vetting process are committed to doing the best we can and as deliberately as we can. Such a statement from the top U.S. Homeland Security official doesn't exactly instill confidence in the vetting system. Islamic radicals around the world are chanting death to America and mounting barbaric attacks on Western targets. ISIS is specifically saying, we will strike America at its center in Washington. Top administration security officials have told Congress that the refugee vetting process is not adequate. In fact, FBI Director James Comey told this committee that while the vetting of refugees has improved, the reality is that with a conflict zone like Syria, where there is dramatically less information available to use during the vetting process, Director Comey could not offer anybody an absolute assurance that there's no risk associated with admitting Syrian nationals as refugees. And not only did his boss, Attorney General Lynch, not refute his statements, but she conceded that there are in fact challenges to the refugee vetting process during her testimony in this committee on Tuesday. I wrote to the President last month
asking why he continues to ignore the concerns of some of his top security officials. And I look forward to the witness's thoughts on such concerns today. Exactly who the individuals fleeing Syria are is also a question of immense concern. There is little doubt that members of the Islamic State and some of the foreign fighters who have streamed into Syria over the last few years are now some of the very individuals leaving the country. In September, the Director of National Intelligence, James Clapper, noted regarding the millions of individuals fleeing Syria, "I don't, obviously, put it past the likes of ISIL to infiltrate operatives among these refugees. So that is a huge concern of ours." Media accounts note non-Syrians trying to pass themselves off as Syrians to try to get into European countries. And articles point out the booming fake identification document industry, where a forged Syrian passport can be bought on the Turkish border for as little as $200. I know that the administration is trying to implement the refugee laws that Congress puts in place, but if implementation places Americans in danger, it is clear that Congress must take a look at the refugee provisions in the Immigration and Nationality Act to determine what changes should be made. Lastly, I'd like to thank the witnesses for testifying here today. I know that some of you had to rearrange your schedules to make it here today, and we appreciate your willingness to testify on this important topic. Mr. Chairman, thank you. I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The chair will now recognize the gentleman from Idaho for 5 minutes of questioning.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you to all the witnesses for appearing here today. I'm actually a proponent of their refugee program. So when I hear somebody like Mr. Hetfield talk about us as if we're going back to the 1930s, I'm actually very offended. I think your testimony was completely out of line and out of place, because most of us are here concerned about the safety and security of the United States, while at the same time we want to make sure that we can continue with this humanitarian program that has helped so many lives, so many people throughout the world. So it was very disappointing to hear your testimony. The mission, however, that we have with humanitarian concerns must not come at the cost of our national security. With recent testimony from both FBI Director James Comey and Attorney General Loretta Lynch that the administration is not able to properly vet incoming refugees, Congress has a duty to act. We're not acting out of just plain fear based on, you know, a few members of Congress just talking to each other. We're acting after we have had testimony after testimony after testimony from our top national security experts telling us that we have a problem with the vetting process. Ms. Richard, you reference an intensive security screening that all refugees must undergo prior to admission. Do you think that the current vetting system is appropriate?
Yes, I do. It's the toughest one for any traveler to the United States, Congressman.
It's the toughest one, but do you think it's sufficient for the current crisis that we're in?
Yes, and I'll tell you why. Because anybody we have any doubts about, anyone who we think might pose a threat to the United States in any possible way, is not allowed to come in.
Do you agree with that, Mr. Rodriguez? Yes or no?
I do. I do agree.
Okay.
Yes,
how about you, Mr.
Love
Hedford?
To elaborate.
I do agree.
Okay. So all of you, I assume, disagree with Director Comey's testimony that it is not sufficient when processing that population due to intelligence gaps.
May I answer that question? Because I have given this some thought. You know, what Director Comey doesn't say is that it is normal for the U.S. government to have no information about...
That's not true. He was here in this committee, and he testified that there was a huge difference between the Syrian population
and the
Iraqi population.
And the reason
because
for
we
that
had
is,
intelligence on the Iraqi
correct.
Population.
And the reason for that is Iraqis and Afghan programs were not like the normal refugee programs. We take people who have served for the U.S. military and have worked alongside our troops from Iraq. So there is a great deal of information about them available to the FBI.
Reclaiming
normally,
my time. Reclaiming
you would
my
not
time.
Have that.
No, reclaiming my time. He has testified again and again and again that we don't have sufficient vetting. I trust him, with all due respect, a lot more with my national security than I respect you. You have a mission, which is to bring more refugees to the United States, and I respect that you have that work to do. But I'm concerned about the national security of my constituents. I'm concerned about the national security of the people that are in my district. We have two refugee centers in the state of Idaho, and we are concerned about what's going to happen in the state of Idaho if we don't do the proper vetting. So it's my responsibility to make sure that they are protected. Mr. Rodriguez, I want to briefly touch on the interviews conducted with potential refugees. How are the interview questions generated?
The interview questions are generated.
Your mic's not on.
Apologize. They're generated by first of all, intensive briefing on country conditions, including classified information, as I explained before. They are generated based on the information received in prior interviews of that same individual. They're also generated by the experience and training of that officer and what we have learned from other refugees.
How often are those questions altered?
Well, those questions are determined very carefully on a case-by-case basis. There's obviously constant communication among our officers.
And what's the typical duration of a refugee?
I have observed them to be an hour. I've observed them to be 2 hours. It really depends on the nature of the case. The more complex, the more questions we have, the longer the interview will take. It takes as long as it needs to take.
Okay. Mr. Jones, in your opinion, if security protocols are not updated, what is the future of the U.S. refugee admission program?
Can you repeat the question? I couldn't hear the first part.
If security protocols are not updated, what is the future of the U.S. refugee admission program?
Well, look, I think the challenge we have, as I look at it, is the databases we have that are feeding into the refugee programs. We just have gaps in Syria. In the Iraq and Afghan cases where I was involved in, we had large databases, biometric information, names, based on people who were coming into prison systems at checkpoints. We don't have them here. So I do think this is a notable concern. It's a gap. We have gaps of information we generally haven't seen in many other cases.
All right. Thank you very much.
Gentleman yields back. The chair will now recognize the gentlelady from California, Ms. Lofgren.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Rodriguez, we have heard that refugees for admission to the U.S. are subject to more rigorous screening than any other traveler or immigrant. And this screening is often conducted because refugees in particular may not often have the documents that we would have walking down the street. I mean, they have, in some cases, fled for their lives with just the clothes on their back. They may not have boxes of documents. How do we proceed to establish identity in those cases? I mean, it's not just Syria. If you've got, we had the Lost Boys in Sudan. We had, we have Congolese refugees. We have people who have fled, you know, with people chasing them, and here they are. How do we go about identifying that person?
And I think it's important, I appreciate, Congresswoman, your distinction between Syrians and others, because the fact is actually most of the Syrians that we see do come with documents that are authentic documents on the whole. What we do, though, is an extensive process of assessing, mapping out family trees, aliases, as the case might be, associations. Other processes, when we do have less documentation than is the norm, we have trained our personnel, both, by the way, to recognize fraudulent documents when they are presented, but also to use the interview as an effective way of determining identity in those cases.
In March, the chairman of the committee organized a congressional delegation to visit the Middle East, and one of the most interesting elements of that trip, and I thank the chairman for organizing it, was the trip we took to the refugee camp on the Syrian border in Jordan, and we had an opportunity to meet a large number of refugees. I would say almost all of whom wanted to go home, but their homes had been destroyed. And by the way, they were very grateful to the United States for the efforts that we have made to provide support for them. And that was very rewarding to hear the recognition that the United States has among the refugees for our efforts. But do we ever crowdsource information? I mean, those people had that we met, I mean, some of them were computer science students, some of them were widows. I mean, you can find out a lot about somebody by doing not just an interview with them, but crowdsourcing the information with everyone around them. Do we do that?
Well, we do so, that's a great phrase, Congresswoman. We do so in two respects. One, we're always comparing and vetting what we hear from any one refugee or family of refugees, which is more typically what we're encountering, with what we're learning from other individuals from that town. In fact, as we see refugees, they tend to come from at least the ones we've admitted so far tend to come from particular areas in Syria. And also, as part of the classified information that we receive, there can well be information that gives more detail in the manner that you've described, Congresswoman.
So in terms of the role of the Refugee Corps and the additional training that they receive, what supplementary steps are taken by officers with the Syrian refugees as compared to all other applicants?
The manner in which they are briefed on country conditions and regional conditions is more intensive than what we do for any other officer. So they have their basic training on protection law, their basic training on refugee law and interviewing. They then have two series of intensive briefings. One is a general briefing on actually Syria, Iraq, and Iran. And then prior to deployment, there is an eight-day period when they receive intensive briefings, both of an unclassified and classified nature, from a number of different sources, including consultations with security experts, to really steep them in the specifics of the environment they're going to at the time that they are going to it. So there is an effort to ensure that that information is current. Once in the field, those individuals have a 10-day mentoring shadowing period before they are able to move off and interview on their own.
I see that my time has expired, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Gentlelady yields back. The chair will now recognize the gentleman from Virginia.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director Rodriguez, I'd like to follow up on that line of questioning. If the interview process is so effective, why do we have 5 million overstays in the United States? 5 million people who were lawfully admitted to the United States through the interview process and have overstayed their visas, violated the terms, violated the promises they made when they entered the United States.
What I can speak to, I apologize. What I can speak to today is the actual refugee process. I mean, I think when we say
that. So you think refugees, where we've already talked about the greater difficulty of obtaining background information, that you have a more highly accurate set of circumstances than you do for people who are applying to come into the United States for other types of visas?
I'm not sure I understood the question, Congressman.
Well, the question is very simple. If the interview process is so effective, and we interview the people who apply for a whole multitude of different types of visas, and they're coming from, in many instances, countries where we have much greater presence on the ground than we do in some refugee countries, and particularly that we don't have at all in Syria, why, nonetheless, with that good process that you describe, do we still have 5 million people who are illegally present in the United States that didn't come across the border illegally?
Yeah,
they entered the country legally after you said they could.
No, I do understand the question now. Sir, what I can speak to is the refugee screening process, which, as Assistant Secretary Richard mentioned specifically as to Syrians, is the most intensive process. It consists just not just of the interview.
As the FBI director noted, you have little inside Syria that you can contact. You can't access local or national databases there. You can't interview neighbors. You can't interview business associates. You can't interview other contacts with the people because they're
they're either in the country and we can't get to them, or they're dispersed elsewhere around the world. Why do you think this interview process is so effective?
Because again, it is based on extensive, detailed mapping of family relationships, associations, credibility assessments based on prior documents, and this is really critical, Congressman. It does not follow from anything that Director Comey may have said that we are querying a void. In fact, people have either been
placed director
on hold or
so.
Denied.
I'm paraphrasing, but he said you can query a database until the cows come home, but if the information isn't in the database, you're not going to find anything. And I think that is exactly what he thinks.
But Congressman, there is information. That is why we have placed people on heightened review. That is why there have been denials. That is why there have been holds.
Why not do what so many members of Congress and other people have said on both sides of the aisle, by the way, and that is hit the pause button on this. You know, the situation in Syria has been going on for a few years now. It continues to deteriorate, and the situation in terms of gathering information about people, we have a problem with forged documents are fooling the Europeans and may be fooling us as well. Why not simply delay this for a period of time until we make sure that the criteria that we've set forth in the legislation that we're putting forward today can be met?
And Congressman, I would say because the process is currently constituted and currently resourced, because your question is the best we can do good enough? And the fact is that it is the most intensive process. It has resulted in denials and holds. It is a redundant, rigorous process through which we put these individuals.
Mr. Krikorian, does the U.S. government have any credible way of distinguishing between refugees from Syria and individuals who are posing as Syrian refugees?
They can try, and I have no doubt that USCIS officials, State Department, FBI, and the rest are doing their best to distinguish between people pretending to be Syrians and people who aren't. But there's a limit to how effective that can be since there's an extreme paucity of data. So sometimes, I have no doubt, they will in fact smoke out people who are lying or cheating. I'm sure it happens all the time. But as Ms. Strack said just last month to the Senate, more than 90% of Syrian refugee applicants are being approved, and that might go down a little bit as those cases that are in limbo are formally decided, but the average worldwide is 80%. So how stringent really can a vetting process be when more than 90% of the people are being approved?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My time's expired.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. The chair will now recognize Ms. Lockman for a brief unanimous consent. Conyers.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I ask unanimous consent to submit to the record of this hearing 37 statements, including from the Christian Reformed Church, the Lutheran Immigration Services, the Southeast Asian Resource Center, and the Disciples of Christ.
Without objection, the chair would now recognize the gentleman from Michigan, the ranking member of the full committee, Mr. Conyers.
Thank you, Chairman Gowdy. My questions seem to be directed to Mark Hatfield. And the first one is, and I respect the important testimony of the other four witnesses, but I'm trying to see how much difference there is between the European refugee model and the U.S. refugee resettlement program. Is there much of a distinction there, sir?
There is a very significant distinction, which is why it is so surprising to me that the attacks in Paris have resulted in even more intense scrutiny of the refugee resettlement program. The refugees who arrive in Europe are not vetted in advance. They are asylum seekers. Their vetting does not begin until after they touch land in Greece or in Europe. In the United States, as Director Rodriguez testified, and as you've heard over and over again, they are vetted, refugee applicants are vetted right side up, upside down, and sideways, every which way you can possibly imagine before they are admitted to the United States. And then the process continues after they arrive. They have to apply for adjustment after a year in the United States. They continue to be under close watch. The risk in the refugee admissions program of admitting terrorists is very, very low.
We're considering H.R. 4038 on the floor today, and conservatives around here argue the bill does nothing more than add a certification process that would ensure no terrorist elements enter the country through resettlement. Do you think that's the whole story behind this?
Well, it is a very short bill, and it does technically add nothing but a certification process. But that process would totally cripple a system without making it more effective. Refugees are already thoroughly vetted, as we've testified, prior to arrival. And having three different high-ranking officials certify each and every refugee case is a guarantee that the system will come to a screeching halt. It already moves so slowly. The refugee resettlement program is no longer a rescue program. It saves lives, but it saves lives very, very slowly. That would bring it to an end.
Mr. Hatfield, you're with the Hebrew Immigrant Aid Society. Now, are you concerned that refugees we will be accepting would pose from Syria and Iraq would pose a specific threat to the Jewish community in the United States?
We are, as everyone else is, very concerned about screening people out who want to do us harm, especially those who have a particular axe to grind against the Jewish community. But again, these refugees are thoroughly vetted, and what worries us much, much more, because we feel the vetting is being done, but what we're also seeing right now is xenophobia, Islamophobia, driving a further wedge between Muslims and the rest of the world, and we're afraid that can do far more damage to Muslim-Jewish relations, to who we are as a country, to our security as a country, and make us even more vulnerable to attack, because we've basically said Syrian Muslims are not welcome here. We do not trust them.
Mm. And my final question to you, sir, is for you to try to explain why our war with ISIS and other terrorist groups is different, because they do not comprise enemy states or governments. Shouldn't the safety and protection of our people be our first concern, even if it means not allowing some refugees into the United States?
It absolutely should be our paramount concern to keep the United States safe and secure. And I can say with great confidence that my colleagues in the Department of Homeland Security are doing that to a fault. That is their mission. They vet every refugee to make us safe. And I really can't imagine what additional protocols they could possibly install to make us any safer. No terrorist in his right mind would use the refugee program as a way to enter the United States. They may find other channels. It's not going to be through the refugee program. It's too intrusive. It's too invasive. It's too thorough in the security checks that it does.
Secretary Richard, do you have anything to add to that comment?
The people who we are bringing are gone through this process, but they're also referred to us in the first place because UNHCR knows the type, the profile of refugee that we want to help. And so we are looking at people who have been tortured, who burn victims from barrel bombs, people who are widows and children, but also the elderly, families that have been ripped apart as members have been murdered in front of their eyes. So, of course, every single one of us feels that the first priority is the safety of the American people. And if we can't provide for that, we would shut down the program. But we believe strongly that by the time a refugee is brought here, we are bringing some of the most vulnerable people, giving them a second chance at life, and we have screened out anyone about whom we have any question. They weren't even probably referred to us in the first place, which may be why we have a higher acceptance rate. And I think that the proof is in the success of the program in communities all across the United States. So thank you for the opportunity to provide some information. And we also will happy, if given the opportunity, to explain more about the nuts and bolts of the process. We think it can withstand scrutiny. The chair and the ranking member of this subcommittee have spent a lot of time on this already this year, but we're happy to meet with other members to go into the point that, for example, the FBI holdings would only tell you a limited amount of information about refugees. For example, if a refugee had ever committed a crime in the United States, the FBI could tell you that. But most refugees have never been to the United States before. So that's why we have to use many more databases and many more techniques and many more approaches to get the full story, make sure their story holds up, and if it doesn't hold up, if there's any question, they are not included in the program. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Chairman Gowdy.
Gentleman yields back. The chair will now recognize the gentleman from Texas, Chairman Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, I'd like to single out Mr. Krikorian and thank him for his excellent testimony. I honestly don't know how anyone could disagree with one word. But before I get to a question for Ms. Richard, Mr. Chairman, I just have to tell you how it seems to me right now, and that is that the President of the United States says he wants to protect the security of the American people. We have a bill on the House floor where the FBI has to certify that a Syrian refugee is not a threat to the United States. And yet the President of the United States is threatening to veto a bill that tries to protect the security of the American people. I have no rational explanation for the President's threatened veto. It is simply astounding to me that a President of the United States would want to veto a bill that tries to protect the security of Americans. I just don't get it. But, Ms. Richards, my question to you is this. This year, we have admitted 1,700 refugees from Syria already, just in the last several months. How many of those 1,700 refugees have been arrested for committing a crime?
So we've brought 1,700 in the last fiscal year, which ended September 30th,
right.
2,000 since the start of the crisis. And as far as I know, none have been arrested, unless you have contradictory
evidence. And do you track all the refugees from Syria, including the 1,700, so you would know?
No, we do not track them after the first 3 months in the United States.
Then how do you know whether they've been arrested for
committing a crime? I rely on the law enforcement agencies to tell us.
Okay. And so far as you know, none of the 1,700 have been arrested.
That's right. I haven't heard of any.
As far as the stopping of the tracking after 3 months, are you going to stop tracking the 10,000 proposed to be admitted next year after 3 months and the 20,000 perhaps the year after? When do you are you going to stop tracking those individuals as well?
Once refugees are in the United States, after a year of being here, they
right.
become legal permanent residents.
Right.
And after 5 years, they're allowed to
and
take
I,
the
I understand that. I'm talking about
and
the,
because
early,
of that,
the early period.
They are treated pretty much like ordinary Americans, and they are not tracked.
Okay. Right. But what I'm saying is, are they treated any differently than any other refugees? Do you consider them to be any more of a threat than other refugees or not?
Well, they're not treated differently than other refugees.
Okay. I think most people would consider to be Syrian refugees, about whom we've already heard.
I guess Syrians are less of a threat, actually, because They've fled their country. They voted with their feet.
Syrians, wait, let me stop you
and
there.
The Iraqis
let me
come
stop
directly
you. No, let me stop
Iraq.
You there real quick. You say Syrians are less of a threat, even though we've had testimony from the FBI director that of all the cohorts of refugees, including Iraqi refugees, we have less information about the Syrian refugees than the others. I mean, the FBI director says he regrets he doesn't have more data about the Syrian refugees, and he has real concerns, and he thinks it's risky. Apparently, the administration disagrees with the FBI director, but you're saying again, I just want to make sure that Syrian refugees are less risky than other refugees?
Well, my point is that Syrian refugees have been outside their country, and so we know what they've been up to, and there's a record of the time they've spent outside
right.
their country.
They
the last
may not
and a half
have
years.
A record of terrorism. They may be would-be terrorists, they may be terrorists in training. Terrorist organizations have already said they're going to use the refugee program to try to infiltrate the United States, and you say you're less worried about Syrian refugees than other refugees?
I am very worried about terrorists.
I'm sorry?
I'm very worried about terrorists. I think we should focus on terrorists. I think we should prevent terrorists from coming to the United
and
States.
Don't you think Syrian refugees might someday become terrorists?
I think the odds of a refugee being a terrorist are very, very small. But that doesn't stop us
right.
from focusing our program to make sure nobody comes in who might be a terrorist.
Right. I appreciate you're trying to focus the program that way, but we've heard from law enforcement officials that you really don't have the data you need to make that determination. But let me go on.
What the FBI has said is they don't have a lot of data
right.
from inside Syria, which makes sense because the FBI has not operated inside.
Exactly. So I don't think there's any way for you to...
And it's also normal for us with most refugees not to have data. The exception is Iraqis
right.
and
But
Afghans.
If you don't have the data on the Syrian refugees, then it seems to me to be very difficult for you to give the American people the assurance that they're not going to commit terrorist
we
acts.
We do have lots of information about Syrian information. The FBI does not have a big amount of holdings on Syrians based on U.S. presence in Syria.
Right. The FBI.
We have a lot of information about Syrian refugees, and Leon's program, and he should probably talk about this more than I should,
right.
is it collects the information and does a fantastic job. I've sat through those interviews.
Right.
Instead of doing scores of visa applicants in a day, they take their time, and they do about three or four right. refugee applicants.
Well, all I can say is every law enforcement official, and I've heard a couple testify before committees in the last 4 weeks, have disagreed with you. They say they have less data, less information about the Syrian refugees. If you're an outlier on that, you're entitled to your opinion. I'm just saying what other law enforcement officials have testified. Last question is this. If the citizens of a state or a city do not want to have Syrian refugees resettled within their jurisdiction, state or city, is the State Department, is the administration going to force them to take those refugees?
Well, there's a legal answer, and then there's the reality answer. Okay. The legal answer is
the
government program, and so the federal government has the right to resettle right. refugees all across America, as we do in 180 countries, all types of cities.
Right, I understand that. What's the reality?
The reality answer is this program only functions if we have the support of the American people, very much at the level of communities and right. societies and towns, to come forward and help these refugees
right.
and help
so,
them get jobs and help them
so,
survive.
So you're saying, I appreciate that, so you're saying the administration, while it might assert that it has a legal right, is not going to force the resettlement of refugees in
well,
locales.
Well, that's for the president
let me finish.
To decide,
in,
but
in
my
locales,
recommendation
me,
would be
let me,
not
let me
to
finish
resettle
my
anybody
let me,
in a hostile
let me finish
environment.
My statement, please. Let me repeat that. You're saying the administration, while they have the legal right to force resettlement, is not going to exercise that legal right if the local communities oppose the settlement of the refugees?
No, I haven't said that, Congressman, because it's up to the president to decide that. But I certainly would not want to resettle anybody in a hostile community. Now, I don't think we have many of those in the United
okay.
States.
Okay, and I wouldn't frankly. Refer to them as hostile communities. They're acting in what they consider to be their best interest in protecting their own people. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My time is up.
The gentleman yields back. The chair will now recognize the gentlelady from Texas. And I would just say, in light of the fact that votes are coming in 15 minutes, I'm going to try to do a better job of limiting folks to 5 minutes, including myself.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and to all the witnesses who have come. Thank you to the ranking member for her valiant effort on trying to strike a compromise with the bill that is being debated on the floor. I was delayed because I was speaking at the Rules Committee and trying to find on the rules on the floor, trying to find a reason for us moving forward with H.R. 4038. But I do want to thank the witnesses, so let me be very, very succinct, if I might. Let me, first of all, ask to put the U.S. Refugee Admission Program Overseas Process Diagram into the record. I ask unanimous consent, Mr. Chairman.
Without objection.
And if I can hold this up, probably it's difficult to see the maze of which it is. So let me say that the inquiry that is being made through this legislation and through this hearing is a legitimate one. Having started on the Homeland Security Committee as the recovery at 9/11 was still occurring, having been to Ground Zero and seeing the angst and feeling that deeply embedded pain, there is no memory that sears the minds of Americans as much as 9/11, although we have experienced much, such as the bombing of Pearl Harbor that resulted in the internment of Japanese Americans. Not sure whether at that time it made the nation safer. So this process troubles me, and I'm going to quickly ask Ms. Richard, Mr. Rodriguez, a scenario. I understand that approximately 23,000 individuals are referred by the United Nations from Syria. I don't know if they include Iraq. Out of that, in the last year, you took about 7,000 to interview, and about 2,000 came forward in terms of the process. The process lasts 18 to 24 months. Is that correct, Ms. Richard, or about 18 to 24 months?
Yes, that's correct.
And they include mostly the people, they include the people who are outside of Syria, who are either in the camps, and not that you directly go into the bowels of Syria and pull somebody out. Is that correct?
We do not operate inside Syria. This is only for people who have fled outside of Syria.
And the individuals' prioritization are those who, women and children, families, 2% of them happen to be unmarried men. Is that correct?
Of the ones we have brought to the United States, only 2% are unmarried single men traveling without family. Right. So most are families, women and children, and multiple generations.
Mr. Rodriguez, have you read H.R. 4038 by any chance?
As it happens, I have, yes.
Very good. Do you, and good, it's not one of our tall ones, it's a limited one.
It was within my attention span, Congressman.
It has not had any hearings. It has not had a hearing before the Homeland Security Committee, which has the basic jurisdiction of domestic security. It hasn't had a hearing in front of the crime subcommittee of this committee, though it deals with refugees, but it also deals with issues dealing with terrorism of sorts. But you are the tactical man, if you will, in this process. As you look at it, do you read it as I read it, that the elements of certification or the persons engaged in certification must certify every single person, Syrian or Iraqi? Do you read it in that terminology?
I would not dare right now to opine or interpret
on legislation.
Other than to say that I'm aware of it.
But you sense
I will talk about what we do right now and what we're planning.
Well, let me do this. So maybe somebody else wants to opine. Because I think you can opine, and I need you to understand it to be understood. It says that everyone in this category has to certify each refugee, does it not? Can you say that?
Yeah, I think our basic position, as the president stated last night, is that the process does 4038 doesn't add. It doesn't add anything to the already rigorous process in which we engage.
Okay. Well, do we have any other Democratic witnesses? I'm not getting anything from that. Let me go back to Ms. Richard then. And as I read this, each person would have to be independently certified. So if you're a 5-year-old Syrian girl, you would have to be certified by the long list of persons that already do it collectively. Is that not accurate?
Well, I don't know. I haven't spent time looking at the bill since it's brand new. But we do have interviews for cases which are either individuals or families. The interviews that Leon Rodriguez's USCIS carries out are meeting with the whole family and then walking through their whole family.
The general lady's time has expired, and I really do want to give every member a chance, and votes are imminent.
So I'm going to
thank you. I yield back.
Thank the gentlelady. Chair will now recognize the gentleman from Iowa, Mr. King.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank the witnesses, and I direct my first question to Mr. Rodriguez. And that is, when you do this extensive vetting process, do you take into account the religion of the applicants?
We do not accept as that being a possible, in many cases it is, a basis of persecution. It is one of the categories of persecution. But we do not disqualify anybody because of their faith.
Do you take into account, do you ask them, what is your religion?
Again, if that is part of the basis for their persecution, then we do inquire into that, sir.
And whether, and even though the law requires whether it is or isn't the basis for that, that you're required to take into account religion, then can you explain to me the data out here and what we're seeing happen in the real world? And by the way, I just came back from there a week ago. I was in the Kurdish region and over to the front lines as close as I could get to ISIS and into a refugee camp and up to Turkey and on over into Hungary, Croatia, and Serbia, and then over to Sweden to see kind of the end result. But I ask in Turkey, take me to the refugee camps where I can talk to persecuted Christians. And they couldn't do that. And I said in Kurdistan, take me to the refugee camps where I can talk to persecuted Christians. They couldn't do that either. And the reason for that is the Christians are being taken into the homes that exist in the area and being taken care of in that fashion. It almost turns out to be exclusively Muslims within the camps as near as I could determine. I don't have data. I just have the answers that I got to the questions I asked, some of them from state, I might add. And so can you name for me or identify for me a suicidal terrorist that was not a Muslim?
I'm not even sure to answer that question, Congressman. What I can talk about, Congressman, here today is
well, why can't you answer that question? Either you can say I can or I can't. That's pretty simple.
Would the gentleman yield?
Yeah.
No, I wouldn't. I'd ask the gentleman if you would also prefer to simply say that the administration policy is not to utter these words. We have to walk around this subject rather than directly speak to it, then I'm willing to accept that answer too.
What I can say is that we do our job, and that if terrorists are attempting to gain admission to the United States, then we do our job to prevent them from doing
but
so.
But you're vetting them.
I think that's what the American people are asking of me.
You're telling me that you're doing a thorough vetting process, but you aren't able to tell me that you specifically ask them what their religion is. And if you don't specifically ask them, then either are you able to quantify the risk to the American society. But I want to move away from that a little bit. I think my point is made there, and I'd like to make this point, that we're operating here on completely the wrong premise. We're operating on the idea that we can vet potential terrorists, no matter how much professionalism that we can bring here, and examine them up, down, sideways, as the gentleman testified, and that they come into America then, and we're going to be okay if we do a good job of vetting the refugees that we would allow into America. And yet, when I look at the situations here, for example, here's a Daily Mail article, here's a headline, America's Enemies Within, how nearly 70 have been arrested in America over ISIS plots in the last 18 months, including refugees who had been given safe haven, turned out to be bringing terror against Americans. Nearly 70, that number is actually 66. And so I understand that we can't be perfect with this, but some of these people that came in as terrorists were vetted. I don't think they were terrorists when they got here. They became terrorists after they got here. They became radicalized. Some were and got through. Some were radicalized. And so when I look at this, I think we're talking about a huge haystack of humanity. And that hay is benign, relatively speaking, but in that haystack are the needles called terrorists. And the proposal that's coming from the administration is that we are so professional that we can examine all of that hay and we can identify any of the needles in it, terrorists, and we can sort the needles out of the haystack and somehow prevent them from coming into America. We're not putting them down to Gitmo where they belong, but not let them come into America. And then this haystack will be benign and it can become part of our culture and society and it'll assimilate into the broader American civilization. That's nuts to think that. And furthermore, even if it wasn't, then I'd say to you the benign hay that now you've envisioned that we've already purified and cleaned the needles out of, now that hay never, ever morphs into a needle, a terrorist. But we know, even by this article, that People are radicalized in this country. They attack us. We've got multiple attacks in America. When I look at the map of Europe and the dots of the hot spots where they've been attacked in nearly every country in Western Europe, and it's proportional to the populations that they brought in from the Middle East and North Africa. Now, we cannot stick our heads in the sand and say that somehow that we're not bringing this upon ourselves. We are watching this. We're slow-motion cultural suicide in America, slow-motion, a generation behind Europe. And I've traveled all over there, and I've walked down through the no-go zones in country after country in Europe to see it, and I sat down and talked to the people that are there, and I'm watching them. They feel so guilty about political correctness that they're willing to accept about any kind of violence brought into their country because they feel guilty about this.
The gentleman is out of time.
And I will conclude with the chairman then, and if we are going to save ourselves, we have to also intervene and provide a safe zone, an international safe zone, for the persecuted religions, which are the Syrian Christians and the Chaldean Christians. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Chair will now recognize the gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Gutierrez.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman. You know, we're all shocked and horrified and deeply saddened by the news coming from Paris. As a member of the Intelligence Committee, I know there is much to fear, both from our allies, both for our allies and for us. But in light of the attacks on our ally, France, last Friday, I urge my colleagues to keep a cool head and not to react exactly the way ISIS and other terrorists hope we do, with fear, with chaos, and with lashing out. But sadly, that's what we have seen Republican governors and elected officials and candidates and media figures do. I've been here long enough to know a thing or two about opportunism. Maybe it's just too much to resist when you got 15 guys and a lady running for president on the Republican side. Politicians, pundits, and celebrities will be tempted to say whatever they can to get in front of the news cameras and have them pointed at them. The governor of Illinois, my home state, could not resist saying that our state was close to Syrians fleeing the terror of ISIS and the Assad regime. He said there was no place in Illinois for women, children, elderly, Muslims fleeing the Assad regime and the ISIS terrorism, the murder, the rape, the selling into slavery. There's no place for those children and for those women. Luckily, just as he said that to show the opportunism, a wonderful Syrian family arrived in Chicago just 2 days ago and found a safe place. That is the message that destroys the hatred of ISIS, not the reel that they're going to have of people saying, we don't like Muslims, we can't trust Muslims, Muslims are somehow going to create a cultural system in America that's going to destroy us. Every community of people that has come here has strengthened this nation. And I just have to say that when you use fear, and I do remember, Mr. Chairman, last year we were here, and the last fear that I remember talking about was when the kids showed up. Remember when the kids showed up, the refugees showed up from Central America? We had doctors, medical doctors, I don't know what medical school, saying that those children were bringing Ebola to the United States of America, that somehow they went to Africa, came back, crossed the border, and came here with Ebola. A year later, where's it at? Remember? I remember governors saying that they were going to close down their states. Every time we hear this, it's about they're coming because they're murderers, they're rapists, they're coming because they're drug dealers. It's fear, fear, and fear. And you know what? The best tradition of America is when people have stood up against fear mongers who traffic in hatred and bigotry and prejudice. And that's what I sadly believe is happening now with Syrian Muslims fleeing. Oh, if they were only all Christians, some would say, then it would be fine. You know what that kind of reminds me of? It kind of reminds me of the Irish when they came here. They said if they were only white Anglo-Saxon Protestant, but no, they had an allegiance to the Pope out in Rome, so they were, well, therefore they were suspicious people. We've heard these arguments time and time again in America, and America has always responded to them correctly by welcoming those to our nation, regardless of the faith that they hold, so that they could celebrate that faith, so that they could live in that faith freely in America, because we don't have those kind of tests here. Look, We used fear during World War II. Boy, did we regret it. The internment camps of the Japanese, a stain and a blemish on America. We used fear and we used bigotry to say that those who would flee the prosecution and the persecution and the death of the Nazis and the Holocaust, we said, no, there's no room in America for you. There's room, certainly, in America. I understand that there is a terrorist system out there that wants to hurt us. I understand that. But I also understand that there are tens of thousands of American men and women patriots that are out there protecting the homeland every day. And they're not working 100%, they're working 200%, and they're keeping us safe. And that we are taking all of those measures, and they don't willy-nilly just let anybody go through a screening process. No, those are Americans watching out for Americans. And I think we impugn their integrity, and we impugn who they are and their patriotism to this country. So I would just like to say, look, we made the mistake before. Let's not make it again. Let us have a system. If you said all we want to do is, Luis, we want to add an extra layer, that'd be good, but that's not what we're doing. They're in the camps. They're getting vetted. We should welcome them to America. We shouldn't fall into the trap of ISIS. I can see the real now. Thank you so much.
Gentleman yields back. Chair will now recognize the gentleman from Colorado, Mr. Buck.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director Rodriguez, I want to just tell you about my experience. I was the district attorney in northern Colorado, in Greeley, Colorado. We had between 1,500 and 2,000 Somali refugees, mostly Muslim, if not all Muslim, come to Greeley. There were some hiccups in the process, but for the most part, they were welcomed and have lived there happily and in a community that is open to them. How many refugees are there around the world that are in a position to come to this country? How many potential individuals are there?
Well, we have our admission target. My understanding generally is that there are about 19 million refugees worldwide.
Did you say 19 or 9?
19 million.
19 million refugees worldwide.
Assistant Secretary Richard can correct me if my number is off, but the number is the largest it has ever been.
Okay. So we have 19 million. That's all I was wondering. 19 million refugees. How many of those, how many of those can come to the country? What is our number that we would allow into the country?
Currently, every year we establish a target. Our target for this fiscal year is 85,000.
Okay, so 85,000, a drop in the bucket of those 19 million. Why are we taking, why would the administration object to a pause on Syrian refugees when we have 19 million potential refugees that we could take from other countries where we have been successful in integrating those refugees, for the most part, into communities in
this country? Because a quarter of all of those refugees worldwide are, in fact, Syrian. The potential for an even greater number exists with the continued activity of ISIL.
Okay, so let's take a quarter. We have 75% of 19 million people, and that, again, 85,000. We could certainly find 85,000 from that 75%. Why are we so interested in taking Syrian refugees? This isn't a matter of religion, as my colleague from Illinois pointed out. There have to be various religions in that 75%.
The situation in Syria is devastating to the extent that there is no reasonable prospect of return to that country.
And taking 85,000 Syrians wouldn't do anything to change that devastation either, would it?
It would start us on the road. It's something that we are doing alongside our European allies. The Germans, for example, are expecting 1.5 million people.
I want to move on. I understand. My point is simple. There are plenty of other people that we could take in, hit the pause button, and do some research on this. Director Rodriguez, Mr. Hetfield said that he was surprised that attacks in Paris has resulted in more scrutiny for America's refugee program. Are you surprised as an American that there is fear in this country over relocating Syrians into this country?
Congressman, there are enemies of the United States. Those enemies of the United States are in Syria.
I was just asking if you're surprised.
My point is, I know that the United States has enemies, whether they are in Europe, whether they are in Syria, whether they are...
Your point doesn't answer my question. My question is, are you surprised that Americans are fearful over what happened in Paris?
I am neither surprised by the fact that there are fearful Americans. I'm not surprised by that, nor am I surprised by the fact that many Americans want us to be a welcoming country to those, in fact, who are victims of conflict and war.
Okay. And so let me tell you one of the reasons why Americans are distrustful at this point. We have a president who, after the murder of an ambassador in Benghazi and the murder of three heroes in Benghazi, four people total, told the American people that that the attack was the result of a video. We have a Secretary of State who immediately identified that it was not the result of a video, that it was the result of a well-planned attack. And then the administration paraded out one official after another to lie to the American public. And the American public has very little faith in this administration when they assure the American public that somehow they're able to determine that Syrians that come to this country are going to be trustworthy and we will be safe. And it's a result of this administration's lack of credibility that has caused the fear and panic among many of the Americans in this country. I yield back my time.
Gentleman yields back. The chair will now recognize Mr. Trott.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director Rodriguez, kind of following up on Mr. Buck's questions, do you think Americans have a right to be fearful today in light of what happened in Paris and the threats against New York and Washington?
Sure. I mean, there are threats to the United States. There's no question about that, okay. Congressman.
And do you think, I'm going home this afternoon, and so what should I tell my constituents that we're doing about their fears?
What we are doing is engaging in and I assume we're talking about Syrian refugees, because there's a whole lot more that we're doing to protect the United States that goes beyond just what we're doing to scrutinize the 10,000 or so people.
Your assumption's correct.
Who may be coming. What I would tell them is that this is the most rigorous process in the history of refugee screening, that in fact we have denied people admission. In fact, there are hundreds of people on hold because either their stories lack credibility or because there was derogatory information about them. So the work is being done.
Okay. But can you sort of understand the complete lack of confidence that most of my constituents, whether it be veterans over the VA, seniors over the future of Social Security, families over the affordability of their health insurance premiums, as I go back to Michigan, can you sort of understand why people have apprehension about the competence of the federal government, Congress included?
I do think, Congressman, I think it's actually a benefit of this hearing that we have a little bit more of a burden of information with people than I think we perceived. I think we need to make sure the American people understand in a calm, reasoned dialogue what we are doing, because what we are doing is rigorous, it is extensive, it is redundant, it is careful.
And you're, sir, 100% confident that the process we have in place is going to work just fine going forward?
It is a meaningful, rigorous, robust process that we are engaging in as aggressively as
in your mind, there's no value in just hitting the pause button. So, many people have made this vote this afternoon into a political vote. It's not political at all. What Congress wants to do, and I think there'll be many Democrats that join us, is hit the pause button and work in a collaborative fashion to make sure that our homeland is safe. There's no value in considering doing that in your mind?
I stand by what I've said about the process, so I don't think it's necessary that I repeat it. I do think we need to think about the costs of inaction.
And I spent 30 years in business. Processes can never be improved upon?
And in fact, we are working every day to make sure we refine our understanding about what's going on in these countries. We learn more, by the way, as we screen each and every refugee. So, of course, there's room for improvement. But the process as it exists is a robust, intensive, meaningful process.
Okay. I'll yield back my time. Time is short. Thank you for being here today, sir.
Gentleman yields back. Chair now recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Ratcliffe.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Appreciate you holding this hearing and your leadership on this issue. I appreciate all the witnesses being here. I had a telephone town hall meeting with the people of the 4th Congressional District of Texas that I represent just two nights ago, and it was similar to many of the telephone town hall meetings I've had before, in the sense of I had about 8,000 people on the line at once. I had as many as 300 and 400 people in the queue to ask me questions, and that's pretty typical. But wasn't typical was the uniformity and lack of diversity in the questions that I had. I didn't have a single question about Obamacare. I didn't have a single question about government overreach and the EPA. I didn't have a single question about $18 trillion of debt. I had 300 and 400 questions about the Syrian refugee issue and the concern that ISIS may try and use gaps in our process to make America less safe. And there's really no exaggeration or hyperbole in what I've just related to you. And I think it underscores and highlights the grave concern that the people in my district and I think around the country really have about this issue. And it's particularly relevant for us because Texas in the last year has received, historically has received the largest percentage of refugees for resettlement of any state in the country. Last year, for fiscal year 2014, 10% of all arrivals in the United States were resettled in Texas. And I think, or hope, that we could all agree that the conflict in Syria and ISIS's stated and promised efforts to infiltrate the Syrian refugee process presents us with a unique challenge here. And in light of these challenges, I think it's incumbent that we all honestly assess whether our system is equipped to protect the American people. And if it's not, we've got to hit pause while we fix the problem. And I know some have demonized this opinion, saying it lacks compassion. But to those folks, I would emphasize that America is the beacon of freedom to the world in part because it is a refuge, because it is a safe place for people to come. And if we sacrifice national security, we will weaken one of the very aspects of our country that attracts the weak and the vulnerable to our shores. So with that in mind, I want to start with you, Director Rodriguez. I understand that an applicant for refugee status must be cleared or must clear all required security checks prior to final approval of their applications. But with respect to this process, do we admit individuals unless something negative appears during the screening process, or do we admit only for those for whom we have information?
We need to have confidence, one, that they can sustain the claim for refugee status. They're screened according to priorities by the United Nations High Commissioner on Refugees. That's why a substantial number of them come as family units or victims of torture, victims, people who've been injured in war. We screen very carefully as to whether there are exclusions or bars that they apply, whether they have been affiliated with a terrorist organization. We have, in fact, ruled people out on those bases or placed them on hold because we had suspicion that those bases apply.
So, I mean, to interrupt, but so it sounds like we screen based on do we screen on the presence of information or based on an absence of information?
We screen for both. We screen for both. In other words, if there is insufficient information, insufficient context for us to be confident that this person is who they say they are and their claim is what they say that it is, then that would be a basis at a minimum for that case to be placed
on. Okay. So let me move on quickly. Because I want to address it from a state and local perspective, and I understand that the current law requires consultation with state and local government officials regarding refugee settlement in a community, but I understand that the extent to which that consultation actually takes place varies greatly. The consultation is supposed to result in the development of policies and strategies for the placement and resettlement of refugees. But as all of you probably know, as of yesterday, more than 25 governors, including my governor in Texas, issued statements saying they would bar Syrian refugees from settling in their states. So I want to ask that question. What would consultation take into account a desire on the part of a state's governor and residents to decline to accept refugees?
Congressman, I think Assistant Secretary Richard will take this question, actually.
All right.
on the issue of consultation with state and local governments, you are absolutely right that that is an important aspect of this program. We require that the local organizations that are partners with us in carrying out the refugee program have quarterly consultations, that they do this with the community leaders. Every state has a state refugee coordinator who is reporting to the governor, but who works with the Department of Health and Human Services to make sure that there is suitable provisions made for the refugees. One of the things that Chairman Gowdy has reinforced in our discussions is that it's important that our partner organizations talk to the people who are the most responsible authorities at the community and state level, that they don't just talk to people who are interested in the program, but that they go to the police chief, the mayor, the school principal, the healthcare center, and make sure they know who's coming, what to expect, and that this then reinforces the community's acceptance and preparedness to welcome the refugees. You're right that Texas is the most welcoming state in the United States for hosting refugees, and I was surprised that so many governors spoke out so quickly. I think that what we have to do, we had a phone call with all the governors that the White House arranged the day before yesterday, and I think we have to get more information out to people so that they understand what this program is, how it operates, and why we take such care in making sure it's done in a way that's safe for the refugees, of course, who've been through so much, but especially is run in a way that the security of the American people is not endangered.
I'd love to follow up, but my time has long since expired. I'd appreciate to thank the chairman for his indulgence.
Gentleman yields back. I want to let the witnesses know votes have been called. In fact, the clock's on zero, so I am more than likely to miss votes, but I don't want you to think that any of my colleagues left because of disinterest. They've been called to the floor. It's just a really important issue in my district, so I'm willing to risk the wrath of missing votes to ask some questions. And I wanted to go last because I wanted to hear everyone else's perspective, and I wrote a number of notes down, and I think I wrote them as accurately as they can be written. And this is the thought that kept going through my head. This past weekend, I saw a gentleman in my hometown walking away from a gas station carrying a gas can. So even I could figure out his car ran out of gas, and I had to make a decision whether or not I was going to offer him a ride. And I did. I offered him a ride. That's a risk, however small, that I was willing to take for myself. I would never ask any of you to do that. You have to weigh and balance that risk yourself. I'm willing to get on an airplane today because I want to get home quicker. The risk is very small. Something bad's going to happen. I'm not willing to go bungee jumping, even though the risk may also be small that something bad's going to happen. So I haven't heard a single one of you say there's no risk. In fact, you can't say there's no risk. Even Mr. Hetfield, I think he put two varies in front of it. He said it's very, very low. I don't know if it warrants two varies in front of it, but there is some risk. Nobody has said there's zero risk. And I think every one of you would agree that the potential consequences of us getting it wrong are maybe cataclysmic. I mean, we have to be right every time. So the risk can still be small, and something bad can happen. And what I'm trying to get folks to do is weigh and balance the risk versus the potentiality of us getting it wrong. So let me start here. Have we ever gotten it wrong in the past? Now, I'm not talking about Syrian refugees. I'm talking about any category of refugees. Have we gotten it wrong? Has our vetting failed in the past? Is anybody aware of a circumstance where our vetting has failed in the past? Not all at once.
I'll take that one, Congressman. The answer is yes, many times. Just earlier this year, an Uzbek refugee, admitted as a refugee, was convicted of assisting terrorism. A couple of years ago, two Iraqi refugees who in Kentucky who had been admitted, it turned out they had their fingerprints turned up later on IEDs. And so critics of skeptics, the defenders of bringing Syrians, they insist on saying no one has been convicted, no refugee has been convicted of terrorist, no Syrian refugee has been convicted of terrorist activities in the United States. But these Iraqis killed Americans abroad. That doesn't make me feel better.
Well, the conviction,
they didn't do it here.
The conviction doesn't mean anything to me. The terrorist attacker is not going to be convicted because he's dead. So you can't use conviction as a barometer for whether or not somebody has been a threat. They may not be around to convict. So does anybody disagree that there have been failures in vetting? Does anybody take the position that we have made no mistakes?
Chairman Gowdy, I agree with you that in the history of the 3 million refugees who have come here, there have been a handful who have been a threat to the United States. And fortunately, they have been stopped before anything bad happened. And the two Iraqis in Kentucky were the most shocking example. They had done bad things in Iraq. They had lied to get into the country. And had our current system been in place, they would have been caught before they came, before they got here. And that's why the system has been improved since that episode. You had said few things in life are risk-free. I heard the governor of Washington State say you take a risk when you get out of bed in the morning. I mean, there's a lot of dangers in the world, absolutely. But I think the program that we run does as much as humanly possible to reduce the risks of bringing refugees to this country. And we have great confidence in it. And we invite members to come out to the field and meet some of the people who interview the refugees and sit through some of the briefings by Leon's team that I've sat through. It's a very impressive, a very thorough event.
And Ms. Richard, that's what makes me hate waste, fraud, abuse, deception so much, is that when anyone engages in it, it also impacts those who would never consider engaging in it, because it makes everyone have to stop and think. There is some risk. There's a great reality that if we get it wrong, something bad could happen. And you have to balance the risk with the potentialities of something bad happening. And when you do have people who abuse any system, believe it or not, there have been federal judges who undergo rigorous screening, including going back and talking to neighbors from 25 years ago. And they still turn out. We get it wrong with them from time to time. United States attorneys, serious FBI background checks with every available database. We still get it wrong from time to time. Even members of Congress, believe it or not, we get it wrong from time to time. So that's what I'm trying. We can't do it this morning, but you can't say there's no risk, and I appreciate the fact that nobody's tried to say that. We all agree that we are dealing with an enemy that affirmatively wants to do whatever bad thing they can do to us. And I just think it's put the American people in a really, really tough position, particularly given the fact that public safety and national security are the preeminent functions of government. I do want to end, Mr. Richard, by thanking you for coming to South Carolina and noting that the reason you had to come to South Carolina was nothing that you had done. And to Mr. Hetfield and others in his line of work, you're exactly right. The sheriff needs to be talked to, the superintendents need to be talked to, the community needs to be talked to, not simply people who may be supportive. If you want to find out the truth, you got to talk to everybody, including those who may not support the program, so you can weigh and balance the competing evidence. You should not have had to come to South Carolina, quite frankly. You should not have had to. It should have been done well before you and I ever met. So I think a lot of the information, the sooner it's shared and the more fully it's shared, the better people can make informed decisions. So as I leave to explain to the majority leader why I missed a vote, this is what I would encourage everyone to do. I really, Mr. Rodriguez and Ms. Richard, what I really wanted to do if we weren't going was get you to walk the American people through every step of the vetting process. I really do like the director of the FBI. But I also acknowledge that the FBI may be experts in this realm of data. You have access to other realms of data. And again, people can draw whatever conclusions they want to draw. It's really none of my business. But until they have all the facts, you can't draw any conclusions. So to the extent you or someone else can just lay out for the American people every single step and every database you can access and every question you can ask and the training of the people doing the questioning, folks are still going to come down on different sides of this issue. They just are. But at least they'll know they did it, having access to every bit of information. So with that, I want to thank all five. I do want to thank the administration witnesses for agreeing to a single panel. I know that is unusual, but given the circumstances of the day, it was a necessity. We'll thank all of our witnesses. And with that, I'm going to head to the floor, and we're adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman.
I'm the leading state sponsor of terrorism.